Hello, everybody, and welcome to Hopkins at Home. My name is Adam Sheingate. I'm a professor in the Department of Political Science. I wish I was speaking to you from this lovely seminar room in, that you see in my virtual background, but this is the next best thing for me to talk to you today about the politics of food. I've been teaching a version of this course for more than a decade, and each year I learn something new or think about some problem differently. And it's hard to decide actually what to talk to you about tonight, given the short time that we have together. But one of the best things for me about teaching a class on food politics is that food is related to everything. We can think about the global dimensions of the food system, or we can focus on literally what's growing in our backyards and everything in between. Now, as I hope to show in this brief talk, food is not only central to our daily lives, it provides crucial insights into essential questions about the global economy, about our politics, and ultimately about our communities. And especially as we look back upon the last year, the experience of the pandemic can also tell us a great deal about our food system and how our food connects to the larger questions of politics and economics that I want to talk to you about this evening. So to give you just a quick overview of what I'm going to do, I'm going to start by briefly describing some of the features of the food system, and in particular, how our food system is built for the efficient delivery of cheap food. That will provide us with a backdrop for understanding the pandemic shock to the food system that we witnessed, particularly last spring, but is ongoing in some respects, important ones. And among the most important consequences of the pandemic, certainly here in the United States and in Baltimore, is the economic toll that the pandemic has taken on many Americans. And this revealed the extent and the limitations of our food support safety net. Now, after looking at how we've kind of fared nationally, I'll talk a little bit about the politics surrounding the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, otherwise known as SNAP, previously known as food stamps. And then we'll get local and we'll look at how Baltimore has responded to the pandemic. And I'll conclude by suggesting that the lesson of the pandemic is that we need to work toward a more democratic and a more resilient food system. Now, the food system is a complex one. It's a complex combination of politics, health, environment, society, economy. And a characteristic of a complex system is that everything is connected to everything else. So change in one part of the system can have ripple effects through the rest of the system. A complex system like the food system also has what we call emergent properties. It's more than just the sum of its parts. And this makes addressing the problems of the food system, whether it's the environmental costs of industrial animal production or creating more equitable access to nutritious food, challenging, to say the least. So that's an overview. Everything's connected. There's all these different elements to it. But I want to focus on one crucial element, and that is the very concentrated nature of the food system in terms of production and in terms of its market structure. In fact, a small number of firms have a very large share of the market. And we can see that here in this figure. And so if you look closely, you might notice that here are some products that you may yourself be familiar with or purchase. But the reality is that many of those products are in fact part of a much larger food company. And so this shows us kind of the concentration of the food system, certainly on the consumer side of things. Whether we're choosing one product or another, they may all be part of the same large conglomerate. Or we can think about this on the production side. This is showing us the concentration of animal production, particularly slaughtering and processing, in four main firms. And over time, this concentration, this four-firm concentration has increased so that we're now in some sectors looking at 80 to 85% of the business controlled by just four firms. Now, just because you might be a person who likes organic food, that doesn't mean that you're not part of this global food system. In fact, many organic products are also owned by large food companies. And again, we can zero in and look at some of these that you might be familiar with. If we take a closer look here, Bare Naked Granola or Pure Organic or Applegate Farms or Stonyfield Yogurt, these are maybe brands you're familiar with. They're in fact part of very large food companies. Now, one of the benefits of concentrated production is that it allows companies to take advantage of economies of scale. And this lowers the marginal cost of production, and it makes it possible to produce more food at a cheaper cost. And that's been pretty good for consumers, broadly speaking. But it's also important to note that cheap food comes at a price. There are health costs in terms of diet-related diseases from processed diets, high in sugar and fats. And there are environmental costs in terms of soil degradation or loss of water quality or greenhouse gas emissions associated with animal production. And as we think about the effects of the pandemic, it's also the case that systems of concentrated production are vulnerable to supply chain disruptions. What we learned over the last year, for instance, is that meatpacking plants are very vulnerable to COVID. And this had consequences for our food supply. As you can see here, a number of meatpacking plants closed because of COVID or had very large outbreaks. And partly as a result of those supply chain disruptions, we've seen price hikes, particularly in the beef market. And I will come back to thinking about these consequences toward the end of my talk. But the point that I want to bring out just for starters is that although in the short term, we might benefit from a highly efficient and concentrated food system, there are long-term consequences. And the lesson, or at least one lesson of the pandemic, is that we have to consider resilience as a feature of our food system. And by resilience, I mean the capacity to withstand shocks, either through multiple or redundant systems or other elements that I'll talk to about later tonight. The point is that resilience is how we prepare ourselves for risks. Now, another way to think about resilience or the capacity to weather shocks is to focus particularly how individuals and individual families weather the pandemic storm, and especially the degree to which they could avail themselves of forms of assistance in order to survive the economic dislocation that many families experienced. So this shows us kind of where things stood before COVID when we look particularly at food security. And by food security, we're talking about the ability, obviously, to feed one's family. And when we think about food insecurity, we can think about either the concern that one has that food might run out or that the money might run out, or more extreme forms of food security, very low food security, would be conditions where people actually reduced their consumption, maybe missed meals, maybe even lost weight as a result of it. So when we think about very low food security, that's something closer to what we might think of as hunger. But food insecurity, even without that loss of caloric intake, still has a deep psychological toll, which I'll come to in a minute. So before COVID, about 10% of households were experiencing some kind of food insecurity, and about 4% this very low food security that I just described, meaning that meals were skipped. The numbers are quite a bit higher for households with children, about 14% and 6% respectively. And the other thing you can notice from these figures is how much food insecurity increased in 2008, 2009 during the Great Recession. In other words, our economy more generally is a lot like our food system, built for efficiency, but susceptible to shocks. And so for a lot of Americans, these economic shocks push them off the ledge where they were just getting by. That's kind of how things are normally. And then when we experience these deep economic dislocations, a lot of people find themselves unable to provide for their families. Now, fortunately, we do have a safety net. And as you can see here, that safety net does respond to these economic shocks. So what I'm showing you here are changes in participation and benefit spending on SNAP, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, which is the main program in this country to provide nutrition assistance. But then, as you can also see, this increase in SNAP usage accompanied the increase in unemployment that occurred along with the Great Recession. Now, I'll say more about SNAP in a minute, but it's just so for those of you who are not familiar with the program, this provides recipients with an EBT card or a debit card that they then can use to purchase groceries at a supermarket or other food retail outlet. It cannot be used for prepared meals. It can't be used for tobacco or alcohol. And most recipients are getting a few hundred dollars per month from this benefit. Now, even before the pandemic hit, as you can see from this figure, the red line here showing us that even before the pandemic in early 2020, there were about 36 million Americans receiving SNAP. Once the pandemic hit, that number jumped to 43 million, and it's now beginning to gradually subside. And that's what a safety net is for. As you can see here with the blue bars, these are the weekly unemployment claims summed by month. And as you will recall, in March and April, we experienced this extraordinary jump in unemployment, millions and millions of new claims being filed. And along with those new claims being filed, we had millions more people finding their way to the SNAP program. Here's another look at the data here, looking at food insecurity, not just in the United States, but by comparison as well with Maryland, at three points in time, March 2020, July 2020, and then most recently, the data that I have is from February 2021. And here I'm looking at moderate food insecurity, which I described is the concern that you might run out of money or might not be able to purchase the healthy food that you used to buy. Maybe your diet has had to substitute cheaper foods instead of fruits and vegetables. That's what we mean by moderate food insecurity. And then severe food insecurity in this case are families who are missing meals because they are unable to purchase or acquire food. And as you can see again, a very pronounced jump in all sorts of both varieties of food security between March and July, and then something of a subsidence as people are finding their way back to work, although still we're at very high levels in Maryland, particularly for those experiencing severe food insecurity. We're basically experiencing about 10% of Marylanders missing meals multiple times a week because they don't have enough money. Now, in addition to public programs, I think it's important to point out that many people rely on charitable sources of emergency food. This could be from a food bank or perhaps just friends and neighbors. Maybe their local church or synagogue or mosque is where they've been getting access to donated groceries or meals. And this is, of course, a sign of tremendous generosity that is characteristic of this country. And I myself have been fortunate to have the opportunity to work in a food distribution site in Baltimore County. And it's really a meaningful experience, but also a very poignant reminder of how much need there is in our communities. I also think that this increased reliance on charitable giving is a sign telling us something about the holes in our safety net. So that many Americans are unable to feed their families even with programs like SNAP. And in fact, to call this emergency food, I think is actually incorrect, because the reality for many Americans is that food pantries and other forms of food distribution are not just for emergencies. And in fact, they are routine sources of food for many people. And so it's important to keep in mind that in addition to these public programs, there's still a tremendous reliance on charitable food distribution programs in order to make up the gap or fill the holes in our public programs. There's also an emotional toll of food insecurity that I think is important to point out. And this is again from recent data collected by the Census Bureau, the same source of data that I was showing you about recent experiences with food insecurity as well as reliance on emergency food. And what you see here is if we compare respondents who have enough food or the types of food that they wanted, and we compare that with people who had enough food but not always the type they wanted, perhaps they're substituting cheaper foods in their diets or less nutritious foods in their diets, and then also looking at people who actually are experiencing missing meals, they didn't have enough to eat multiple times in a week. And then we look at their psychological reactions to the pandemic. We see quite a pronounced disparity. First, it's remarkable how many people, even with enough food, are experiencing some form of distress, whether that's feeling nervous, whether that's being unable to stop worrying or feeling depressed. But as you might expect, the experience of food insecurity is associated with much, much higher rates of these forms of psychological distress, particularly depression. And of course, that is something that is, I think, probably not surprising, but also particularly given the importance of providing food to our children, that the inability to do so, I think, is one factor contributing to the high rates of distress that we see. It's also important to point out that this psychological toll does not fall evenly on people. And in particular, it's borne most heavily by women, partly because we have a lot of single-headed households headed by women, but also because women are predominantly responsible in many households for what we call food work, the preparation and planning of meals. And just to give you a sense of that, I just want to show you the following figure, which I think is very telling. What I'm showing you here in the yellow bars is the response of women in countries around the world to the question of who does most of the work in terms of preparing meals and shopping for food in your household. And this is the percentage of women answering that women do. And so in the United States, about 55% of women say in the survey that women always, that they do in their household, always or usually prepare meals or shop for food. What you also will notice about this figure is the responses of men to the question of who performs food work. And in every country around the world, men say that women do less work preparing meals than women themselves say they do preparing meals. And that difference between what women say they do in the house and what men think women do in the house, I would describe as invisible food work, the invisible work of preparing and planning meals. And so when we think about the psychological cost or burden of food insecurity, it's partly unseen as well, because it's something internalized by women as they think about the struggles they face providing for their families. So why is it that we have this hole in our food support system? Or why is it that the SNAP program is just not enough? Well, for one, the benefit is pretty limited. And as you can see here, for a family of four, the maximum benefit is around $650, just a little bit less than $650. And that obviously goes up with larger households. It goes down with lower households. And the reason why it's set at this level is because according to the USDA, This is roughly the minimum cost of a healthy diet, what they call the thrifty food plan. And according to the USDA, the cost of a thrifty food plan for a family of four is right around $680. And so the maximum benefit for a family of four is set just below that. And it's worth thinking about your own family budget for food and how it compares to the thrifty food plan versus what is described as the moderate cost or liberal food plan. Now, the idea of SNAP is, as the name describes, supplemental. It's the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. And so it is not designed to cover all of the costs associated with food purchases. But in times of severe economic dislocation, this leaves many people struggling to feed their families. And that's where they have to look for other sources to make up the difference. It's also not easy to get SNAP. It's not easy to enroll in the program. And this is somewhat by design. There's something that scholars refer to as administrative burdens. These are features of the program, administrative features of the program, the application process, the certification of eligibility that makes it hard to locate benefits, to comply with the rules, and also to cope with what is a stigma associated with social programs and in many cases, the experience of enrolling, the experience of having to admit you need help, and also to provide the documentation in terms of financial resources that's required. All of these add up to obstacles that reduce the numbers who successfully sign up. And so we always face a condition where the number of people who are eligible is greater than the number of people who actually enroll in programs like SNAP. Now, as I said, some of these administrative burdens are by design. And here I want to say a little bit about the politics surrounding the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, and in particular, some of the criticisms that we see around SNAP. Now, the idea of making it difficult to acquire these benefits. The idea behind that is that if you make it harder or if you make it more challenging to acquire benefits, it will make it less likely that someone gets something that they don't deserve. And in terms of the politics of social programs, typically we see conservatives articulating concerns and criticisms of social programs like SNAP. And they focused on a couple of concerns that I want to describe here. One is the concern that social programs should not be available to able-bodied adults without dependents. That's sort of the technical term that we find in policy. The idea is a childless adult should not be eligible for social programs. And that's partly because of the second issue, and that's the concern that many conservatives articulate that social programs create work disincentives, that people, instead of getting jobs, instead avail themselves of social programs. And so conservatives often articulate the view that these loopholes have to be closed. It has to be more difficult in order to eliminate these disincentives. There's also concerns about other aspects of the program that conservatives argue make it easier to become eligible. So for example, in many states, if you already qualify for one type of social program, you are automatically considered eligible for SNAP. For example, if you've already qualified for some kind of heating assistance, then the state will automatically consider you to be eligible for SNAP. And then finally, there is a concern that people can too easily defraud the system, that it's possible for people, again, who don't deserve the program or who have not acquired the benefits legitimately to nevertheless avail themselves. And so that's another concern. I will say that in terms of the evidence for these concerns. They are disputed. For example, fraud is very minimal and certainly very low by standards of other programs and in terms of the overall cost. There's other contested questions about the effect of work requirements, evidence suggesting that requiring people to go to work to get these benefits doesn't necessarily eliminate the need. So my point more is just to give you a sense of these political debates, but also to pose a question. Given the political contestation around the SNAP program, how did the SNAP program survive, especially when we think about other forms of social policy that have been scaled back over the last 20, 25 years, for example, cash assistance, other programs that have become more limited. SNAP is actually a program that has continued. And as I showed earlier, remains a safety net, right? It does increase. It is available to people when they need it. As we see unemployment going up, we see SNAP enrollment going up as well. So there's an interesting political question here, which is why and how did SNAP survive when other types of social programs have been scaled back? Now, to answer the question of how SNAP survived, I think you have to ask another question, and that is, who benefits from the SNAP program? Now, remember that this program makes it possible for people to purchase food. That's the only thing they can do with this benefit. It's not like a cash transfer. It's an EBT card that they can use at a store, but it will only be redeemable for certain types of food purchases. So what we see here when we look at the redemption figures, and these are in billions of dollars from 2018, that most of the money that is redeemed through SNAP is redeemed at very large supermarkets and box stores like Walmart. Walmart is in fact the largest single point of redemption for SNAP benefits. So when we think about the politics of SNAP, it's important to remember that food retailers benefit a great deal from this program. In a sense, the government is subsidizing sales at these retailers. Now, I've done some of my own research actually has looked at the politics of SNAP. And one of the papers that I've written has looked at lobbying on SNAP. And so this is some results from a paper I recently published that looks at who lobbied Congress on nutrition programs like SNAP. This is figures from the 110th to the 115th Congress, which ran from roughly 2007 to the end of 2018. And what you can see here in the upper right-hand corner is that the food industry is the most active lobbyist on nutrition programs. And the food industry includes not just retailers like Walmart or giant supermarket, Safeway, but also includes PepsiCo, Coca-Cola, and the other producers of food. And so I think this evidence suggests that these companies are committed to seeing SNAP continue because it benefits their business. It benefits their bottom line. And so I think that's an interesting thing to consider when we try to understand the politics surrounding a program like SNAP. Now, I want to switch gears a little bit and come back to the question of how the pandemic has created great need in terms of food security, and also the way government has responded. And to this point, I focused really on kind of the federal level and the role of SNAP. And now I kind of want to get more local, and I want to look in particular at how Baltimore has responded to the pandemic. And one of the things that you may not know is that Baltimore is a real center for innovation when it comes to food policy. And this is because of something called the Baltimore Food Policy Initiative. This is an intergovernmental collaboration that by that has been in existence really since really for over a decade. It's both inter and intra-governmental. It's intergovernmental in the relationship between the city and the state and the federal government. It's intra-governmental in terms of the cooperation between various elements of the city government, including kind of quasi-governmental entities like the Food Policy Advisory Council, Food Policy Advisory Committee, which is a task force that has made recommendations and includes a lot of diverse stakeholders, including retailers, including community groups, including religious organizations, and so forth. It's also interesting to point out that the Baltimore Food Policy Initiative really grew out of a very close and productive partnership with the Bloomberg School of Public Health, the partnership between the city and the Bloomberg School, and in particular, an entity known as the Center for a Livable Future, which is a research institute housed in the Bloomberg School, which has really been at the forefront of research on questions of community food security. The Baltimore Food Policy Initiative has a director who's housed within the Baltimore Office of Sustainability, and as we'll see, they've really been at the forefront of responding to the pandemic. Now, before looking specifically at those responses, here are some of the elements of the Baltimore Food Policy Initiative, and it's really focused on these various strategies. One is to think about how to create a more equitable food system, which means how to improve access to healthy, nutritious food for people who live in Baltimore City who lack that access. Those are neighborhoods with concentrated poverty that also have limited access to healthy food and also experience higher rates of diet-related disease like diabetes, stroke, and heart disease. And so trying to implement these policies, create a more equitable food system, and doing so in a community-led process. There's also, as you can see here, trying to increase resilience at the household, community, and food system level. And I think that term resilience is really key here, both from a kind of system level, as I've just described, what allows a system to be resilient to shocks. And although we have a food system that's really great at delivering efficiency, what we know from the pandemic is it's actually not so great in terms of resilience. It's vulnerable to disruption. But when we think about community or household resilience, we're also thinking about the capacity of communities and households to withstand these shocks, like I just described. And that points our attention again to the important role that these programs and policies play to catch people when they find themselves pushed off the ledge, as it were, the safety net that they need when they fall. And then finally, to strengthen and amplify the local food economy. And this is something, again, very important in light of the pandemic. On the production side, we know that trying to create a more sustainable food system at the local level is important, but we also know how important the food economy is to so many people, because so many people are employed in the food system. And so strengthening the food economy is also something to think about when we look ahead, but also as we reflect back on the last year. So what has Baltimore City done? And this is just to give you a couple of a look at some of the innovations and responses. The first thing to point out, if you look at the figure on the right hand of your screen, is the just tremendous increase in SNAP enrollments as a result of the pandemic, a 600% increase in applications between April and the summer of 2020. And that's just, again, indicative of what I would say is the precarity that many people live in on a daily basis, even before the pandemic, but that we then see revealed because of the pandemic, that that so many people found themselves really at a loss to feed their families once they lost their jobs because of the lockdown or the pandemic. On the more hopeful side, however, as you can see on the left-hand side, the city really did respond with some innovative ways of delivering food to people, produce boxes, grocery boxes, meal delivery locations. And this really occurred throughout the city. As you can see from these maps, the figures may be a little bit difficult for you to make out, but I think it does show these areas in red and pink are areas of higher SNAP benefit enrollment. So those are areas that also, as you know, the geography of poverty in Baltimore, those are areas of more concentrated poverty. But as you can see from these other figures that the city really was able to go out and provide locations where people could have access to emergency food. And of course, this is happening, as I said, in Baltimore County and in other places. And I guess it speaks to the way in which it's really at the local level, whether that's the city government, the county government, and the state government, that we find the innovations needed to respond to the pandemic. On the right-hand side, I add this figure for us because this shows us the area in the immediate vicinity of the Johns Hopkins University campus, the District 14, and the neighborhood that is nearby that also has a high rate of food insecurity and SNAP usage, as well as opportunities and places for people to access emergency food. But again, I want to focus on that the possibility for innovation at the local level. And that's brings me to my concluding comments about the lessons of the pandemic and the possibility for food system change, as well as what we need to think about as we look ahead to the future of our food system and our future as we move hopefully out of the crisis of the pandemic. So as we think about the possibilities for food system change and we see the possibilities and potentials at the local level, we have to ask ourselves how much can be accomplished by localized efforts and initiatives. And in particular, is it possible for these local efforts and initiatives to contribute to a broader political movement and a broader transformation of our food system? There are a lot of problems with our food system that I could only touch on briefly tonight. As I said, the fact that our food system contributes to diet-related disease, the fact that there are environmental costs to our food system. There are a number of issues that that need addressing. And the question is, how are we going to get there? And is it possible to do that from the ground up, from the local efforts and initiatives that we've seen where the innovation seems to be taking place? How do those efforts join up? And then where is the greatest potential to create what I think is the need, a more resilient food system? I'll say more about that in a minute. And then the big question, I think, really is, can we enhance democracy by focusing on our food system? When we talk about food democracy, we're talking about the capacity for people to shape their own food system. And we see an example of that in Baltimore, that it is possible for Baltimore, for the city of Baltimore, and for residents in many communities in Baltimore to take agency, to have agency, to take initiative. To shape their food system. That is a form of democracy, a form of collective problem solving in the food system, in the food space. The question is, will those efforts perhaps lead to spillover effects that will have benefits for our democracy more generally? That will make it, if people get involved in fixing the food system, will they want to get involved in other aspects of our political system and become engaged in a way that will be healthy for our democracy more generally? And so this brings us back to kind of the crux of the problem, if you will, which is that we face these competing food system goals. As I said at the outset, we've created a food system that's built on efficiency. And that is really about the optimal allocation of resources. How do we produce the most food at the cheapest cost? And that has become central to our food system, to our diets, to our society, to our economy. We all benefit from, in that sense, economically benefit from a cheap food system. But as I said, that cheap food system actually has hidden costs to our health, to our environment. And so we have to consider the trade-offs from this efficiency. And the lesson of the pandemic is there are deeply concerning vulnerabilities that come from this focus on efficiency. In order to address that, we have to focus on resilience. And that's the ability to recover from disruption, or to at least withstand the disruption, or to weather the storm. How do we build resilience into our food system? Well, perhaps by deconcentrating production to a certain degree, by making possible other forms of access, by creating a more robust safety net. And then finally, we have to think about the sustainability of our food system. And that means really the protection of non-renewable resources that are crucial to the production of food. And when we think about the climatic consequences of food production, and we think about the consequences for food production of climate change, we are facing a potentially very deeply existential threat from climate change. And the consequence of climate change will be felt predominantly in our food system, and that will have political consequences, which I'm happy to speak to more about in the Q&A. But the point here is that these are competing goals, and currently and historically, we've really only been focusing on efficiency. And now we have to rethink our food system so that we can incorporate considerations of resilience and sustainability. And if we do that, I think we will be looking at something more like a democratic and more resilient food system. And so what I envision, or what I think might be the direction we have to strive for or grasp toward, is to first think about what is a democratic system really. And it's not just about elections and parties and what we normally think of. When we think about democracy, it's really about the capacity for participatory, pragmatic decision-making. It's the ability for us to collectively come together and solve our problems. That's really what democracy in a deep sense means. Similarly, resilience is a system that is not just able to withstand the shocks that we encounter, but the reason why it's resilient is because it's adaptive and dynamic. And it's those features of a food system that we need to kind of embrace. And so when we think about kind of the political and the ecological, the sort of elements of democracy and resilience, the pragmatic and the adaptive, I imagine thinking about kind of democratic resilience as the goal of not just our food system, but of our communities more generally. And so with that in mind, I hope that you take away from this discussion perhaps a better understanding of the food system and how we fit into it, as well as its challenges and maybe the goals we can collectively strive for moving forward. So with that, I'm now going to turn to some of these questions that have been coming through. This first question is from Oscar. Are there models that demonstrate how to protect the diversity of our food supply while addressing some of the larger impacts on the quality of food and environmental impacts? I think the answer I would say is yes. I mean, I think we know a lot about how to protect the diversity of our food supply. I think the challenge really is a political one, and it's how are we gonna, as a society, address these trade-offs between efficiency and resilience. And any kind of trade-off, you know, comes with a cost. And so that cost might be in a different diet that we have to consider, perhaps a diet that is less intensively focused on meat consumption. It's not that we have to stop eating meat, but maybe we have to consider eating less meat, or maybe we consider different sources of meat. We also have to think about the politics of, and anytime we think about politics, we're really talking about power and whose voice is heard in the political system. And as I showed earlier, in terms of, you know, lobbying expenditures, governments lobby a lot on nutrition programs, nonprofit organizations lobby a lot on nutrition programs, but the food industry also is the biggest lobbyist, as I showed you. And so we have to think about where power resides. And that's really, I think, the challenge when we want to think about these trade-offs and in this case, how we protect diversity. This is a question from Maria about the role of public school meals and food security and how it was impacted by COVID. That's a great question. Some of the figures I showed you earlier in terms of emergency meals and emergency food showed that actually a lot of the emergency food is through school-based programs. Some of that, as I described about my own experience, is working for something called the Student Support Network, which operates in Baltimore County and has food distribution sites at a number of schools, so schools as locations. But one thing about public school meals that some of you may be aware of is that a lot of kids get their nutrition through free and reduced lunches at schools. And so one of the consequences of the pandemic was that by closing schools, we were unfortunately eliminating an important source of food for kids who needed it. And some of that has been met through other sources. But when you look at the numbers, it's just so clear that the number of free and reduced meals that we provided in the last year has cratered. And that's only been partly made up through other sources. And so it's still early days. I think we're gonna be untangling and discovering the consequences of the pandemic on food security and on kids in particular, certainly in terms of the educational effects for years to come. But Maria's question is well taken that, you know, public school meals are such an important part of food security, and the loss of the closure of public schools really impacted a very vulnerable set of kids. Some of that we've been able to make up, but some of it I think is, we'll have to do more study to try to understand how those families coped during this period. A question from Bob about how the government assigns dollar amounts to these resources. I think this is in reference to SNAP. Bob also says it feels similar to the minimum wage, which cannot sustain a working person in many cases. So that's a good question. So how does the USDA come up with these figures? The first answer is that they have a lot of really well-trained experts in nutrition and a lot of data that they collect on the cost of food, and then they calculate diets based on different combinations of foods that make up that diet. But again, this is a political question, and one of the things about teaching food politics is to try to help my students understand that it's really about the politics of policy. That we might be able to identify a solution to a problem, but the political process will shape how that solution gets crafted. And sometimes the outcome is not always ideal. Sometimes, particularly when you think about the minimum wage or you even think about the thrifty meal plan, a lot of politics is about not just getting something to happen, but sometimes about making sure things don't happen. And so if we think about opposition to increasing the minimum wage, that essentially freezes a policy in place that over time reduces the value of that minimum wage because of inflation. In a somewhat similar fashion, the thrifty meal plan and the way in which we've designed the SNAP program around it has failed to update the realities of people's lived experiences in terms of what it costs to feed a family, what a diet really looks like today. And in fact, one of the things that might happen in the new, relatively new Biden administration is that some of the appointments to the USDA have been of individuals who in the past have been critical of the thrifty meal plan and have been advocating for its revision. And so it's possible that we will see changes to SNAP in the coming years. It's also the case, something that I wasn't able to get into today, which is that through the pandemic, there were increased benefits associated with SNAP, increased dollar amounts, so that the average family was actually getting a bit more through SNAP as a result of the pandemic, so that the benefit might have been able to be stretched a little bit further. But I think it still goes back to something that I said earlier, which is that in this country, we have long had an element in our politics which is very concerned that somewhere somebody might get something they don't completely deserve. And as a result, we've crafted policies in a way to be somewhat stingy, for lack of a better word. And we see that in SNAP as well. We also see things that are, somewhat, this gets back to the point about being outdated and about difficulties revising programs. So SNAP can only be used to purchase food. But one of the elements of SNAP that I often tell my students about, which I think illustrates sort of the limitations of the program, is that although you can spend SNAP on foods that we would say don't have a great deal of any nutritional content, like sugar-sweetened beverages, you can buy SNAP. You can use SNAP to purchase those sugar-sweetened beverages. You cannot use SNAP to purchase a rotisserie chicken at a supermarket because that is considered prepared foods. Now, I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't be able to purchase soda with SNAP. And I don't believe that just because you're poor, you should have limited choices necessarily. But we do need to look at these programs and to think about, is there ways that we could make it better in terms of allowing people to have a healthy diet? Question from David, is there another country which provides more appropriate levels of resources to meet their own people's food insecurity needs? The answer briefly is yes, that there are other countries that do provide a more robust safety net, both within the food domain, as well as in sort of the more general social support domain. For example, Scandinavian countries tend to be more generous in terms of social benefits. Some countries, for example, even a country like Brazil has put a great deal of resources and energy into food insecurity and has seen results in improving food insecurity. Some countries actually have in their constitution a right to food, that they have embraced the idea that food is a fundamental human right, and that as a constitutional matter, this is a right that cannot be denied. And so it is an interesting and great question to think about how the United States looks different and how kind of embracing the idea that food is a basic human right might change the conversation a little bit about our food system and our food policies. A question from Chris, are there innovative ways that we can bring or empower communities that have limited access to fresh foods to develop sustainable solutions? I think there are a lot of innovative ways out there. And I think some of the ones that I just described that have been going on in Baltimore are great examples. Others, including efforts to encourage urban agriculture, community farms, food to school programs, the role of institutional purchasing, where you can leverage the purchasing power of a city or a university or a hospital in order to benefit local economic growth in terms of the food economy. And so I think there are ways to do that. And the type of thing that we see happening in Baltimore, in fact, is happening in a lot of communities around the country. There are a lot of what are called food policy councils in lots of cities or counties or other regional areas. And these are I think of as great examples of kind of the pragmatic participatory decision-making at the heart of a democracy, where people coming together to say, how are we gonna solve this problem and what innovations can we come up with to do it? And so I think that is really hopeful. The question then becomes, first of all, measuring the effects, and that's a research question, but also joining up these efforts. Like, how do we, and they are obviously the people who are working in the space of community food security are already involved in networks of experts and activists. And that's great. The question is, can it have a transformative effect on the larger food system? There's also a question to be asked, however, about whether the focus should be on the food system or on broader economic needs, right? So is it enough to just focus on getting people access to food? That is to say, you know, through improving diet or improving food security programs? Or do we need to think about economic engines that will allow people to have greater individual income and wealth that allows them to afford a better diet? And that's, again, an important political question. Question about volunteering in Baltimore City. I think there's a lot of great places to volunteer. I think that anywhere you can find, go do it. And whether that's associated with the school system, as I have worked in Baltimore County, or with another organization. One organization I'll just give a shout out to, because I've always been a big fan of it, and one that's close to the Hopkins campus, is the Franciscan Center. And I think they do a tremendous work in terms of providing access to healthy food, as well as a whole bunch of other services for folks. Let's see here. This is a question from Gordon. What are the broad economic impacts of shifting back to more traditional farming models, smaller farms with smaller scale food production for local communities? That's probably a question for an economist, but I think that, I think it gets back to the question of how can we combine what we already have in terms of a kind of concentrated industrial food system with alternative forms or more localized food production that allows for local farms, smaller farms, but connected in ways that also enhance community food security. And again, because I'm a political scientist, I'm going to go back to the politics and the policies of these things. We have to also look at the policies that govern agriculture, the subsidies that are pretty much unavailable to smaller farmers compared to larger farmers, policies that have allowed for a great deal of consolidation and concentration in the farming industry, just like in other parts of the food system, antitrust, other things, as well as just maybe reorienting our spending priorities away from, to some degree, the production of bulk commodities like corn, cotton, wheat, and towards fruits and vegetables, towards smaller production. And so again, thinking about how our policy priorities can be more effectively aligned with our needs as a society when it comes to our food system. A couple of comments here. One is from Diane, finding that the number one reason for bankruptcy was medical costs, and also that rural areas have a great deal of need. And again, I would agree with both of those points, that everything's connected. Our medical system is also one that is pushing people to the edge of solvency, and that in turn makes them more vulnerable to these economic dislocations. And rural areas absolutely have a tremendous need for healthcare, and also for food, also face food insecurity. And so, again, I think part of the political question moving forward for this country generally, in fact, one of the great political divides we currently see in our political system is between urban and rural. And we have to think about how to talk about politics in ways that bring people across the urban-rural divide together. What are the common concerns and needs? Finally is a question from Sheila, comment about animal production and cruelty in animal production and meat production. And what kind of policy changes can we use to move away from that? And I think that is a really vexing question. I think for a variety of reasons, we need to begin a conversation about reducing meat consumption in our diets. Again, I'm not suggesting we all have to become vegan or vegetarian, but for a variety of reasons, including animal welfare, we need to think about reducing meat consumption, but also we have to think about what policy changes might be necessary to make that easier for people, to reward the production of other kinds of foods in a way that will lead to this more sustainable, resilient food system that we've talked about. So the clock I see has turned to 8 p.m. I want to thank everybody for joining me tonight for this Hopkins at Home session. I hope that I was able to at least scratch the surface on our food system and maybe give you, if you forgive the pun, some food for thought as you move through the world. Thank you and good night.